So good morning, everyone. Happy January 21st as we now roll into episode 193. Seven away from 200 of these, which is just still humbling and mind-boggling, I think, all at the same time. Again, I never really thought we'd be getting to this next milestone, but hey, perseverance pays off. So, where am I? So, for those new to this for the first time, again, this is my journey, my AI, GPT, large language model journey. It's evolved over time simply because this is how, before the internet, before bulletin boards, before a whole bunch of stuff, these were patterns, techniques, approaches, best practices I've learned throughout my career as to how to get acclimated or get involved with a new technology. Being passionate about technology has definitely been a plus, but typically these are the four general categories that I look at. Current events, strategy, direction, use cases, job skills. Again, all of this. Good morning, Brian. This again is more of the journey. These are what I would call starting points. I'm always looking for different sources or different angles. Today, I think it's going to be most of the four touch upon the articles I'm going to share today, or at least the first three, which I think are really interesting. And it goes and shows what's going to show is the dynamics that exist within any new technology and how the marketplace reacts to it. I've seen this pattern numerous times before. So again, this is you're kind of getting my insights and my view and my reading list as to what's really influencing me going forward. And I think the first two or three really show why I'm doing what I'm doing here. So let's just dive in. So the first one, literally saw this morning. That's the beauty part about what I do here. There's no writing staff behind me. You're looking at, good morning, Gabrielle. You're looking at the proverbial chief cook and bottle washer, which is me. I wish I could tell you it's scripted. I wish I could tell you I had a teleprompter. Nope. This is basically my reading. You're looking here at PowerPoint slides and then the link to the actual article. And then you're pretty much getting George unfiltered. I mean, I do read this. I do think about it a little bit, but you're really getting kind of almost real-time reactions to, everything that I'm presenting. This one actually showed up this morning. So let's just go to the article. It was a Fox News, Fox Business. AI will create long-term job disruptions, which is from KPMG. So, this is so new. I'm sorry. I did not, hang on. I didn't change the underlying text. That's how new this was. I got distracted on something. So let's actually read the article. I'm sorry. Normally I like to put it on the slide. I'll have to correct that. So, with U.S. consumers and executives both expressing worries about the impact of AI in the workplace, the CEO of one of America's largest consulting firms warned about long-term disruption. Well, we already know disruption is a constant, right? So this idea that disruption is some new thing, okay, fine. I think in the long term, there will be job disruption. 76% of millennials and Gen Z said their jobs are already significantly impacted by generative AI. Now, hold this thought, because the next two articles are going to, you start to see the dynamics of these predictions or these surveys. And to me, that's why when I read these things, I really like to decompose them, because what you're going to find on this particular slide or this article, you're going to see the next slide is kind of the polar opposite of this. So, and that there has not been significant job loss to date. Well, I think that that's true in most instances. Now, mind you, we've talked about the Google, we've talked about call centers. We're talking about the fringe stuff that's beginning to be impacted or at least seen more of an influence. Even this week's, I'm not suggesting that it's generative AI behind the scenes, but even the Sports Illustrated layoff, right? We're starting to see these pressures or this impact of AI in some way, shapes, or form, but I don't know what the final impact is going to be. So let's just continue. Blah, 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 blah. Now, additionally, KPMG findings show 65% of business executives believe generative AI will have a high impact on their organizations in the next 3 to 5 years. So I think that that's a fair estimate. I'm not so sure about the 60, 76%. I'm not suggesting that they're wrong. I just don't know how many, who was questioned, what spaces that they were in. Was it a very focused group? Was it a very wide group? Because if this was a very wide survey, I'm not so sure that it's 76%. So again, this is where the numbers kind of get, oh, what did you just do? You know, I hate. Oh, this is my, oh, really? You know, why? Hang on a second. You know, this is my, these are my technology glitches. Bear with me a second. You know, my Asus router has a bunch of AI built into it as well. So I guess that there was something on that that it didn't like. Blah, 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 blah. Arguing labor market is currently facing other headwinds, not remained optimistic. The economy can absorb what may be a bit of a shock, blah, 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 blah. You think about different emerging technologies we put in place over the last 25 years, there's been a net drop, yet there's been a net job growth and net job loss. Okay, so on this particular dynamic, remember, this is really a truly disruptive technology. I don't believe, maybe you could argue the PC, maybe you could argue the cloud in some respects. Those have truly been disruptive in that they did replace things. The PC replaced the typewriter, as an example. A cloud is replacing the data center, even though we're starting to see more of this repatriation from the cloud in. These were real technologies that had an impact. The others have been additive, and we've talked about this. I think this one, though, is kind of the same level of disruption. The trick is it's going to create different types of jobs that we don't have necessarily the skill sets in abundance for, which you're going to see again in the next two slides. Same study said these individuals who took the survey that they weren't that worried about job disruption. They thought that their mental health would actually improve, meaning that more mundane tasks might be automated, allowing them to do more valuable things in their work. And I talk about this all the time. That which should be automated will be automated. So that everybody has this. This is kind of the first. Good morning, Mike. Yeah, I agree, Mike. Mike's saying, you know, critical mass. Well, we're going to talk about that too, because there's a couple of variations on that I want to get to. Morning, Mike. Morning, Gabriel. I got everybody. Okay. So that's the first one, right? So you get this kind of, okay, we know that there's going to be a disruption. That's true of any technology, number one. It's very hard to quantify, and Mike even puts in, you know, this idea of generic AI, you know, where generative AI, I'm sorry. You know, how do we look at all of this, right? So this is just article number one, some doom and gloom. Some people are saying that they're already impacted. Great. Okay. Now, sorry for not updating the text. That was, again, I did it this morning. Now, the next one gets interesting on a number of levels. This was a Forbes magazine, so I'll give it to you guys so you have it out in the chat. So this is a Forbes magazine article. So let's get to some key pieces. Now, close to 3/4 of executives, 72%, said they are purposely exercising restraint with generative AI investments, mainly due to societal pressures to use AI responsibly. Really? That's the first I've seen a survey that addresses the societal pressures. In fact, any conversation that I hear people talk about, while this is mentioned, this sure as heck isn't number one on the list. However, as is the case with technologies these days, if you don't keep up, you could be out of business. Well, that's just I could use that sentence in any time period. So they are cautiously exploring the potential of the technology, and corporate culture will be decisive in how it gets implemented. Man, I could probably hold a whole session on corporate culture and technology. Let's just say this. This is all about what is the board asking of the company. This is about how individuals within a company are measured in terms of if it's about profit, if it's about cost, cost reduction. There are drivers that are going to supersede some of these discussions. So if we want to talk about, yeah, maybe that there will be a corporate culture that does this, you know, let's go to Google. You know, Google last week laid off people from their ad agencies, largely because, you know, the understanding is that AI has simplified those processes. Did the culture care that it was laying those people off? You could argue that both ways. So let's just take that first paragraph as a, oh yeah, Mike, absolutely. That's Mike's bringing up our, you know, we lost the privacy. That's a whole other conversation as well. So now these are the latest, these are among the conclusions drawn from the latest Accenture Pulse survey on the state of business progress in 2024, drawn from a survey of 3,400 C-suite executives measured against key business indicators. Now, to me, the key business indicators are profit, expense reduction, right? I don't think in many, number one or number two, and how they're incented to move forward is about, is AI going to replace a job? So I already have a problem with the first two paragraphs. They seem to be somewhat conflicting. Now, there was a lot of preparation. And oh, by the way, the reason I put these two together, remember the Gen Z said that 76% or whatever that is have felt impacted? Well, that is in stark contrast to what this is saying, that there's caution. You know, they're still looking at it and they're experimenting. This is why I like to read multiple sources and start gleaning out where these challenges are overall. Now, here's the juicy part. There was a lot of preparation work ahead. Absolutely. We've talked about it here. Only 27% of the C-suite executives in the Accenture survey said their organizations are ready to scale up on generative AI, and 44% say it will take more than 6 months to do so. I'll just say this. If you are going into a company, I really don't care what company it is, one of the first things to ask, one of the first things to explore is, what is their data strategy? Because if they don't have a concrete data strategy, remember, AI wants to ingest this stuff. It needs to understand about the golden source or the record, the system of truth. You're going to need basic fundamentals within a company that says, in order to feed the beast, and we'll call the beast generative AI, what are my sources? Are they defined? Are they crisp? Are they? There's a whole bunch of work just there alone. So this idea that it's going to take 6 months to do so, we didn't even get to the other pieces of this. What are the approved architectures? Do you have people that have vision about this space? Do you understand what the use cases are? Like, my God, the list of things just on generative AI in of itself is pretty long. Most everybody is experimenting. I get it with the RAG pattern and, you know, how do you ingest? Oh, okay, fine. That's a piece of this. But if we look at this holistically, we didn't even get to governance. We didn't get to regulation. We didn't get to licensing. This whole space to me gets me back to why we're going to see companies have an AI office, period. Because there's too many of these pieces and parts. So, you know, when they start thinking about, are you ready to scale this up? Well, scaling a solution assumes you have all the other pieces and parts in place. And I would say to you that we're about a year, maybe a year in, well, let me do the math. A year, you could argue we're a year and a half into this. I'm going to argue that we're a year. I'm going to just use kind of last year as my calendar entry. So from where I sit, we're about a year into this. This is not a simple disruptive technology. Like, again, we've talked about this when it was big data and all these other things that were additive. We're talking about something that will change the structure of an organization in terms of how they manage it, how they build for it, how they control it, how they measure it. So this idea that it's going to take more than 6 months, it's going to take a hell of a lot longer than 6 months. And then notably, however, 76% of the executives saw generative AI as more of an opportunity than a threat and more beneficial to revenue growth than cost reduction. Again, you have to go back to that, the top paragraph. How are people incented? Today, they're incented about revenue. They're incented about cost reduction or cost containment. And the other things may be on the list, but are they a significant part of how they're compensated? That's why, again, taking the previous article and this article, there's wiggle room. There's questions I have. Hello, Horesh, how are you? So that's, again, that's why we have to look at these articles and kind of find where the truth is, because it's in the middle of all of this. Now, the third one, hang on a second. I'm sorry. What am I missing here? George, what did I do here? I'm sorry, I must have hit double hit. Now, the next one that gets interesting is this one that came from the Federal News Network. Agencies see demand for AI in government in 2024. What will it take to pull it off? Federal agencies see lots of possibilities for using AI tools in their day-to-day work, but they've only put a fraction of those ideas into practice. The Government Accountability Office, in a recent report, found 20 non-defense agencies identified more than 1,200 use cases for AI in government. And this one gets interesting for a couple of different reasons. So I'm going to copy that and put that out into the chat so you guys have it. So again, let's take a step back for a moment. And of course, I'm going to forget what the heck that government agency was. Oh, I'm not going to remember it either. So let's just talk about this for a second. This gets interesting because there are some existing best practices that have existed in the government specific to, and if somebody can look this up for me, good morning, Rajiv. If somebody could look this up for me, I'd appreciate it because the name escapes me. And I'm making this up because I don't remember when, 8 years ago, whatever the hell it was. The U.S. government actually came up with a standard, but the U.S. government came up with a standard body that basically vetted all cloud vendors. So what happened was instead of each agency having to go out and check, you know, the security and the privacy and the storage and the costs and the this and the that and the other thing, there was a group in the federal government that said, wait a minute, we've come up with this checklist of stuff. I'm sorry, Gabrielle, what was that for? Do you see the links? Just respond to that. But I forget what the heck it was called. There was a government agency, and if somebody looks it up and types it in, I'll, like, yeah, that was the name. But they actually went through that work of vetting all of these processes so that when an agency wanted to use the cloud, the due diligence work had already been done for them. Great. Well, now in this particular effort, when they start getting into AI, we're going to see, again, I am of the belief we're going to need some type of an AI office. And this AI office, now mind you, there may be multiple AI offices, because I think even though there are subsets of AI from generative AI through machine learning and everything and anything in between, there is a lot of pieces and puzzles. There's a lot of pieces to the puzzle, that need to be answered. And I don't think you want each agency answering it by themselves. For example, how many different databases are they going to create? Are they going to have one centralized database across all the agencies? Who's going to control access to this? Who's going to control what the response is? I mean, this can go on for a long time. The trick here is to show the opportunity. So now if we look at three different pieces of this puzzle, the first one kind of talked to the personal view, in a sense, where people think that they're already impacted. That's one. I have some problems with that, but that's one. The next one talked about the C-suite that's saying, well, wait a minute, we're kind of putting the brakes on this because we're doing it from a look and feel perspective. The third is that you're going to have the government as another employer trying to do or implement these AI-based solutions. So if you look at this, take away the emotional, you know, reaction, there's going to be a demand for a set of skill sets. So when you're looking at this, you can either be reactive, which I have said time and time again. Maybe Gabrielle, it's in the chat. If you go after, when you look at the recording and you look at the comments afterwards, they will be there. I've seen this before, either on LinkedIn or on the Facebook page. So the trick here is realize that there is an appetite to do this, number one. The trick is going to be, where are you in your career? What type of job do you want? And how do you take those skill sets and apply it to what's coming? Because we know that companies are going to want, or going to need this skill set in some way, shape, or form, or a series of skill sets, that's A. We also see that the federal government is looking at this as well. So there's going to be these new types of jobs that are out there. I don't necessarily think they're crisply defined, but from my perspective, I'm looking at this to say, if I ran an AI office, what would be the constituent pieces and parts that I would need? Now, again, for those that have heard this before, I created an open source office. To me, I basically have that framework of what needs to happen in an AI, in an open source office that, and I realize AI is a different space, bear with me. I understand the structure of what that office would need to be. Legal has to be involved. Audit has to be involved. Risk has to be involved. Architecture has to be involved. Executives have to be involved. You have to basically put together this program that says, in order for us to get this value, you need some controls and some framework that's in place. So to me, as I look at all of this, don't get so wrapped up in the articles. Don't get so wrapped up in the predictions. Take that step back and say, wait a minute, based on everything I've talked about here in the different articles that I've shared, start looking at that framework and saying, well, wait a minute, you probably need somebody or some entity that's managing these efforts. What are the constituent pieces and parts that need to be addressed within a company or within a federal FedRAMP. If you look up FedRAMP, 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 geez, about 8 years ago, I guess, maybe 10 years ago. I don't really remember when. FedRAMP was a U.S. government agency that vetted cloud providers. I can imagine something similar evolving because, again, the scope, the importance, the details are such that you probably are going to need that type of an organization as well. So, again, I just wanted to show those three articles to show you when you read these things, don't get too high, don't get too low. Understand that they're trying to get an idea or explain the disruption space. I think very few people really have an understanding as to not only what that disruption is, but what that preparation is. And that's why I do what I do here. And it was a good article too. It had a couple interesting, you know, tidbits in it. I didn't go through all of it, right? One of the other lines, according to the GAO, these agencies have implemented about 16% of all the AI use cases they've submitted. And I think they had, you know, what was it? Thousands or something on here. I forget the other blah, blah. But again, just understand there is a demand. The demand is going through its learning phase right now. This is your opportunity to start picking up the requisite skills. Now, the next two are just more, go back to previous things that I talked about. This one came out, when was this one? This one just came out. This was just like 2 days ago. Microsoft is using Llama, reducing its dependence on OpenAI. Now, we've talked about this a little bit, or we've talked about this on different angles, where there's going to be more than one of these large language models. The question is, how many are there going to be? Are there going to be 5, 10, 50? I don't think there's going to be that many. There'll be built for purpose ones, obviously. But in this one, in his recent interview with Satya Nadella at Davos, Bloomberg's Brad Stone asked if Microsoft was worried about being over-reliant on a partner whose goals and missions might be different than Microsoft's. Newsflash, Microsoft spent about $11 billion, and I think they've got 50% control of that entity. So that's just kind of an interesting piece to that puzzle where Microsoft could throw a little more money and they basically own it at the end of the day, right? I feel we are very capable of controlling our own destiny. Our products are not about one model. We care about having the best frontier model, which happens to be GPT-4 today. But we also have Mixtral and Azure as a model. As a model as a service, we use Llama in places. We have Phi, or I think it would be Phi, which is the best SLM for Microsoft. So, and I think that's small language model. So there is going to be diversity and capability in models that we will have, that we invest in, but we will partner very, very deeply with OpenAI. Remember what I talked about, geez, I think it was even the beginning of last year. For those that know technology, if we go back to the SQL Server days, because this to me is we see these patterns repeat. Way back in the day when SQL Server and relational databases first came out, they had their own proprietary libraries that you had to link into your source code. And what happened was Microsoft actually had this thing called ODBC, Open Database Connectivity, which put a layer or a wrapper around these databases. So basically you could, in essence, snap in different databases, but use the same interface. I see that's going to, I still believe that has to happen at some point in time. I don't think we've gotten to that point just yet. But you're also going to see companies that are offering products are going to have a black box, in many senses of, you know, which model are they using to accomplish which task. So, you know, the earlier point about having these, you know, a generic model versus a specific model, remember, as you push out, as you start getting out to the edge and you get down to the device, you have certain limitations on latency and size and processor and memory and blah, blah, blah. You're going to have different models at different places throughout that, let's just call it a transaction. From the time somebody touches it on their device, whatever that device happens to be, all the way to if it has to go back home to the proverbial cloud, I think you're going to see a multitude of solutions. Each one is doing something specific to the level that they're at. Now, fortunately, you and I don't necessarily need to keep track of that. But if you are in a space where there is an answer that's coming out of that cloud and it's dependent upon multiple LLMs, it gets back to why you're going to need an office. You're going to need to understand at least a corporate level why all of these things work. So it's just good to know that you're seeing these companies experimenting with all of these models. I don't think that there's going to be, is Salesforce or was it ServiceNow, Michelle? I thought Salesforce had theirs and then ServiceNow had a bring your own large language model. I forget which one. Again, you could be right. I don't remember. But I remember one of them had kind of, you know, their model in a sense. To me, it wasn't even so much. The one on Salesforce, Michelle, was that safety layer. And that question, for those that don't remember, if you go back to April, I think it was last year, when Salesforce had their announcement, they showed this safety layer, which was going to reduce hallucinations. I don't know how it's going to pull that off. But that was unique to being in the Salesforce cloud. So if you have LLM that talks to LLM that talks to LLM, who's responsible for what safety layer in these? So again, I'm getting into detail, sorry. But it gets us back to why I think we're going to need to see an AI office, because somebody has to keep track of all of that information. And then the last one I had for this week, and again, when did I see this? This was another recent one that really was a lot of recent stuff this week. Yeah, this was January 18th. This was this week also. OpenAI partners with Arizona State University to use ChatGPT in the classrooms. Now, we know students have used ChatGPT. They've used it to generate papers. This in of itself is not new. This is kind of taking the idea and saying, look, we already know what's out there. How do we embrace it? So, and you know, once it starts getting that impact in the universities, you know, at some point in time, it's going to follow through to corporations. So universities hope to foster critical thinking. Well, I'm not going to comment on that one. So we never considered closing ourselves off from the technology. We want to help determine the conditions in which this technology can be used in education. Last year, Arizona State University launched an AI accelerator program, bringing researchers and engineers together to create AI-powered services. The university also began offering prompt engineering classes to promote AI literacy. I think that's a best practice for everybody. And this is the first partnership between OpenAI and an educational institution. The company has slowly begun to forge collaborations with more public-facing organizations. It announced a deal with the Pennsylvania state government to bring ChatGPT Enterprise to some state employees. So again, we're still in the experimentation phase. You're going to see... I think you're going to see a host of these GPT models come out and interfaces that are bespoke to education and real estate and sales and a whole bunch of other stuff. So again, this is not a surprise to me. It just gets back to, for those listening, we're early. So don't panic, number one. Number two, you need to acquire skill sets, because all of this work continues whether you like it or not, number one, or whether or not you know about it. So from my perspective, these are the breadcrumbs. These are the clues that you need to pick up to say, okay, how do these bits of information impact where what you do and where you want to go? So again, I thought it, just an interesting kind of flow this week, that started with a bunch of surveys that seemed to have some conflicts between them, all the way through some use cases and the breadth of how these things are being implemented and the number that are being implemented. So I get back to 30 minutes a day. If you're not doing 30 minutes a day, I'm telling you, you're doing it wrong. I'm a little, and I'll be honest with you, for as much time as I put into this, the past 2 weeks have just been, I've had a bunch of home stuff I've had to just take care of. It's all good. I've just been busy. This stuff piles up fast. In fact, just yesterday, I was following somebody on LinkedIn that published something about, and I may get to that next week, just at the federal level, the list, I mean, the links, I mean, it must have been, I don't know, 30 to 45 links. And I looked at this and I'm just like, it can be very hard to keep up with this. So that's why I do what I do here, at least keeps me honest, but it's at least sharing how big this beast of a problem or a challenge that this is going to be. And the opportunity is now to get these skill sets. So that's what I had for you guys this week. For those new to this, I stream every Sunday at 9. This is basically the flow, right? It's the articles. It's what am I seeing? How do we prepare? What's the insights in those articles that we really need to focus on? I do have a video repository, which today I can actually begin editing some of this. I know I'm behind, but for those that may have missed previous messages, there's an actual playlist. I was up to November 19th, just to show you how far behind I am. It's about 7 or 8. And then as I get time, I hope to blog a little bit more this year, and I hope to get back to my website. But Rajiv asked a great question. What is the message for businesses reluctant to dip their toes? I'm gonna. Here's how I would answer it, Rajiv, because I think there's a number. Again, I think depending on where you come from, it depends on the angle at which you bring your expertise or your skill sets. I would say this. It's rare that we've seen a disruptive technology to the scope of GPT. GPT is not, and I would emphasize this, and I would raise my voice, the tone in my voice, it is not a snap-on, add-on, complementary technology. Because if you're thinking that you can just add this on later, you're going to be sadly mistaken. The message is you need to understand the disruption to the ecosystems that GPT introduces. It introduces a disruption as to your presentation layer, as to how you interact with both your employees and your customers, number one. It impacts how you think about architecting your data so that you can effectively meet those needs. And you need to understand that there's an incredible amount of investment that's going on that if you ignore this, your competition isn't. So to me, it isn't so much about you need to do something. No, that's not the message that I would give. My message is this is truly a disruptive technology, the likes of which we've never seen before. Yes. Is it perfect? Nope. Does it make mistakes? Yep. Is it ready for prime time? It depends on how you want to answer that question. Can it completely replace a call center rep? No, can't. However, that doesn't mean that there is you ignore it or you walk away from it or you just pretend that it's not there or you wait. And I think that that's the biggest challenge here is that if you're looking for an immediate payback, if you're looking for a 6-month payback, I get it, right? If I spend this much money, how long is it going to take me to get value? I get the whole conversation. This one's a little different. And this one is you need to invest a little time into this. You need to do some experimentation because as we've talked about, there's regulatory issues, there's legal, I mean, it's a list of stuff to jump in later and then try and bolt it on. My experience, my insights, my knowledge of this space says that that would not be an approach I would recommend. So that's how I would answer that question, Rajiv. It's more about it's changing the dynamics as to how we interface with technology. And you need to change how this, you know, God, give me so many examples. You know, if you're an A, define A, whatever you want, and you've been an A for 30 years, and tomorrow you want to be a F. It's a very, very, very rare skill set that can take 30 years of muscle memory and 30 years of experience and 30 years of gut feel, turn all of that off and magically become that next thing, F, Q, Z, Y, whatever it is. Because you're always going to be influenced by, you know, some of those things in the past. And I've said this in my presentations numerous times. If you try to take this technology and munge it, bastardize it, change it so that it conforms to this way of thinking, you will fail 99 times out of 100. I think you'll fail actually more. You need to understand what this does and how it changes this. That's a really hard thing to do for a lot of reasons. So to me, that's how I would answer that, Regine. Yeah, Michelle, what I would say to you is this. We're going to see, so again, off the get into a little detail. You know, earlier in 2023, there were a lot of people that were learning about the RAG pattern, RAG, I forgot what it stands for at the top of my head. Augmented generation. And it's amazing to watch what happened the second 6 months of the year to take the ideas in the RAG pattern and say, oh, wait a minute, we've learned a whole lot more. We then got to the AWS reInvent where they said, oh, wait a minute. Now, mind you, they're not there yet. But they basically said, hey, we can take kind of this pattern and we can quote unquote servicize it. Now there's going to be, I think, two different ways to do this. I think there will be one eventually that you just say, hey, here's my corpus of company data, go ingest it, create me a chatbot and go do some stuff. I think to Michelle's point, you're going to see these low code platforms. And I think that's going to be part of the journey, Michelle, to be honest with you. I think right now it's kind of all, you know, bespoke handwritten stuff today. I think the next layer of abstraction, as it were, is going to be these platforms or these SaaS platforms that offer the tools to say, hey, we're going to give you some tools to bolt all of this together. I think the ultimate, at least on these chatbot layers, is going to be where it's kind of a generic service where you basically say, okay, you know, here's my data store, whatever the hell that is, images, PDFs, docs, whatever the hell it is. Go ingest it, do all the fine tuning work of that, and give me my ChatGPT, you know, interface of this type of persona, and here's all the attributes. I want you to have memory. I want you to blah, 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 blah. So I think there is a continuum that we're going to see in this space. And remember, we're just getting this is still all getting started. There's even within that basic pattern that I talked about, there's a lot of work to understand how to chunk, what are the costs. God, we could be here for hours talking about this. So to me, this is how I'm watching the market at least play out. I think if you go back to the reInvent, the AWS reInvent, which was what, the end of November, beginning of December, go watch some of those presentations where they start talking about this next level of service. And again, I expect Azure to have it and Google to have it. But now that they understand the pattern and they understand how it works, you can begin to automate it or create a service above it. So, I'll tell you, Paul, I don't even know if there's a crawl anymore. I think that there's I'll take what you post and kind of give you a different cadence. I think that, and I'm coming at this from a historic perspective, so bear with me. I think a best practice to learning this is your pattern, crawl, walk, run. I think that's been the traditional pattern. I think things like Agile, I've kind of bastardized that thinking a little bit, where where you basically take the concepts of Agile, which, and now, by the way, this is another, you know, button of mine. You know, when we talk about Agile, Agile is nothing more than a machine, right? It says, hey, we've got the requirements, we've got these pieces in place, go forth and build it because you've done all the planning work. Agile has kind of been bastardized, in my view anyway, where, you know, some of those things, it's like the magic of Agile. It's like, no, there's still some basics of you need requirements, you need some stuff. And I've seen people throughout my career kind of make Agile or think Agile is something that it's not. So that's one. I think part two, in this particular space, because of the dynamics, because of the newness, because of the sensitivity, if you try to reverse that, which is, you know, kind of run, walk, crawl, I think you get back to what happened last year with the, was it Samsung or LG? I forget which one it was, that actually put, you know, company secrets into the model because they didn't understand. I think that there is a fair amount of risk. Let me rephrase that. There is enough risk that you need to understand you just can't jump into this thing. And again, I think that there are patterns that people have been using. The proverbial person in the middle, I think, is a good pattern to mitigate risk. But the thinking that if I spend 3 months and I can come up with something that's quote unquote valuable, that I think to me that's agile thinking. And I'm not so sure that you can take the current state of generative AI and apply. You can apply agile thinking to anything, but I don't know if you can get the results just yet because there's still too many unknowns and there's still a fair amount of education that needs to happen. So I'll kind of balance that out. I mean, I get it, right? I get the, oh, thanks for that, Paul. I will definitely look at that. Rushtree.com. So anyway, ran a little late today. This is one of my longer episodes. I got a little impassioned by the feedback. Normally I like to keep these about a half an hour. So with that said, I hope you find this helpful. Again, if you're seeing it for the first time, my previous stuff is on LinkedIn. If you want to, you know, slog through LinkedIn, I will be updating my, my playlist tonight. Today we'll start that process. And I, you know, again, enjoy your week. I hope you're enjoying this. If you do, tell your friends. This is kind of the narrative of, you know, how I learn and how I love to just share it with the masses. So with that said, on our extended day, have a great rest of your Sunday and a great week. And we will be back again next week to do it all over again. So until then, everybody, take it easy and I'll talk to you then.